My guest today is the bass player who's been with a number of bands over his long career. Over the last 10 years, he's been a member of the legendary group Styx. They are on tour with Def Leppard and Tesla right now. I'd like to welcome Ricky Phillips.
Hey, Roy. How are you, man?
I'm good. How you doing?
I'm doing well. We had a show last night in Los Angeles, and now in, where are we? Palm Springs area, I believe, and we're in Vegas, I believe, tomorrow night, and then Scottsdale the night after that. So we're rolling. Starting the year off. Here we go.
Yeah, no break for you guys. Let me ask you this. Are you getting a chance to do the Def Leppard cruise, which is sort of in between, or are you guys not going on that?
You know, somebody asked me that last night. No, we're not doing that. We will do cruises, but we don't stay on the ship, and we usually do them, I think it's in May, and we'll do maybe 4 ships, but what we do is we'll go to the Bahamas, and then we'll check in a hotel, and as the ships dock, our crew is loading in our stuff, and when they leave, our stuff is already off, and we're back in the hotel, and the next ship pulls in, and so we don't stay on the ships. We did that years ago. Yeah. It was cool. It was fun, but
prefer being on land.
Yeah, ships are cool, but we go stir crazy after a while because, it's limited what we can get done when we're on a ship. But yeah, I didn't even know Def Leppard was doing a cruise, so I'm anxious to talk to those guys about what brought that on.
Yeah, I think that's next week from what I've seen. So
okay, so they must go from that straight to us in Orlando because we're all hooking up. In Orlando, that's our first gig back together.
Right, exactly. Well, I want to touch base on that because that's sort of the big news tour you've been on for a while now was the tour with Def Leppard and Tesla. Started last year. How did that go, and what was the decision to sort of re-up it and keep going?
Well, I think there's a few reasons to re-up it. One, it did incredible numbers. We were one of the biggest selling tours of the summer, which is surprising. There were a lot of really great people I love anyway out there touring. And we just love those guys. We hadn't toured with them in 7 or 8 years. And, it's just funny how time flies and how long we've been doing this. But we get on like a house on fire, man. On days off, Joe and Sav and I will go out and play golf. We used to. We're going to try to make a point of doing that this time out because we should be in some spots where the weather should be okay, starting in Florida. I think we're starting in North Carolina and then Florida. But anyway, when we go through southern Texas, we might catch some good weather. And it goes beyond just the music. It's a friendship, long-time friendship. And those guys are just great guys.
You know, I wonder if sort of the average music listener would, in putting a concert tour together, would think Styx and Def Leppard. It sort of, on first thought, seems
it's
like an odd match, right? But when you get there, you're like, oh yeah, of course, I know every song by both bands.
I think what sometimes happens is, like I was in Bad English, right? And in that era, bands started all looking the same, kind of sounding the same. To get radio airplay, you kind of had to have this homogenized big stadium, lots of delays and reverb sound, and it didn't start off that way. The 60s kind of started, you know, there was the London poppy sound that was maybe similar, but it was kind of blues rooted, came from the love of Mississippi Delta blues or Chicago blues or even Southern Texas blues, like the, well, I guess where you would say Edgar and Johnny Winter came out of. And so there's many things that happen in music. Disco's come in, punk has even come in and taken some bands down. Back in, I'd say, the late 70s or early 80s. Yeah. And so now that it's more of a touring, concert-driven industry, it's interesting what bands go together, and I don't think it is obvious. Ours, and this is a great example, the fans, our fans that might not have been Def Leppard fans became instant Def Leppard fans, and I think that the converse happened as well. And it's just musically a fulfilling night. You're not seeing the same kind of homogenized music. The bands both have a sound that when it comes on the radio, you instantly know it's Def Leppard. You instantly know it's Styx.
Right.
And I think the appreciation for people who may have been, I don't really like those guys, whichever. Minds are changed instantaneously, and both bands are so good at what they do. And Tesla, too. I don't mean to leave them out. I mean, Tesla's sure. A Northern California band, and I'm from Northern California. And I love the fact that those guys have had continued success. I mean, they throw down. They come, they're opening up for both of our bands, and I mean, they make it a full, complete night. So it's just been a good package.
With Styx, now you've been in there for over 10 years easily, right? When did you join the band?
Yeah, I'm in my 13th year. I guess in September I'll start my 14th. I got a call from actually Todd Sukerman first. When he found out that JY and Tommy were going to call me, he and I had met doing sessions together, and we were always a great frustrating for me in Los Angeles is because I loved working with Todd, and I was producing a lot of stuff at the time, and also doing sessions for other producers as a bass player, but I always wanted to use Todd on stuff I was doing, and he was always on the road to Styx, but I never thought of the idea of, well, I don't know if we do this, which is what Todd called me up and said. I wanted to ask if I could be the first guy to call you, which is really cool because there's that special relationship in any band, and every good band between the bass player and the drummer. Styx started off as twin brothers being the bass player and drummer, so it's always had that special relationship and a solid, deep pocket where the foundation is built with bass and drums. So when Todd called me, I was flattered in his enthusiasm and excitement, and also flattered. He said, Tommy's going to obviously call you here in a few minutes, and I want to know. I asked if I could call first and see what you thought and blah, blah, blah. So it started off really on the right sort of attitude, the right foot, and it's just gotten better and better every year. We seem to throw down a little heavier each year the longer we're together. We all still have a great love of writing and still have a great love of what it is to be a good band, to really never, ever phone in your parts, to always show up every night and try to make tonight's show better than last night's show. And that's always been our MO.
Well, one thing I've sort of noticed over the years is that whenever there's an opportunity to see, I don't know what the right word is, like sort of one of the classic bands, a band that's been around and had a long career, if you get to go to see them, it's always a good show because it's gone past sort of the trying to outdo other bands or whatever nonsense is going on, and now it's just they're all so good at what they do, and Styx and of course Def Leppard or whoever falls in line with that, where that you guys are just pros at it, and it comes so easy, and it's a good show, and you get your money's worth.
That's interesting because I just heard my nephew played me. He's 19, and he played me the Hollywood All Stars about 2 days ago.
Right.
He said, "Uncle Ricky, have you heard of Hollywood All Stars?" And I go, "No, I haven't, Cole." And he said, "Well, he was going to take me into the Valley. I was out in Castaic and staying with them, and taking me to my hotel." And he said, "Let's listen to it on the way." And I said, "Yeah, all right, you got it." So I said, "Cole, do you know who is in the Hollywood All Stars?" "No, man, no. Who's in?" He was just—he has a love of just good music. I mean, he'll turn me on to stuff that's new. This is new. But it's guys that I was influenced by and grew up with and have worked with. And so I explained to him all the guys that were in the band, and it's a big list. There's, 15 guys that played on that record. And I as I'm listening to it, I'm going, I heard School's Out and I heard Alice and all the guys playing, it kicks the shit out of the original version. It's just a good song to begin with. But I realized, we thought we were badass back when we came out and we first hit, but most of the guys have just matured as musicians.
Yeah.
To the point, I've always thought that about the band Styx, and it's kind of not my place to say in a way, because I wasn't, although I toured with the original format of Styx, and when I was in the Babies, we opened up for Styx several times. So I thought, man, there's no way that band was, as I'm removing myself from them for a second, that band was as good then as they are now. And before I even came in, I mean, I love the fact that good musicians just improve in so many ways, not just as a musician, but in taste and in style, and having tried hundreds of thousands of ways to play a riff or introduce certain arrangements and vocal harmonies, and just an approach and intensity to songs comes with just being a matured professional at whatever it is you do, whether it's music or whatever. And when I heard the Hollywood All-Stars the other day when Cole played for me, I was like, damn.
That's cool. You know, I suppose an obvious question you get asked all the time is if there is any plans for a new album, and so I got to throw that in there. But, you know, it's been a long time, so has there ever been a talk about a new record?
Well, there's been a lot of talk, and I think that I think it's time. I think that to do it, we're all going to have to. I think we're kind of looking at a couple places in our schedule where we might be able to go in. And we can't do it the way, you know, quick and fast, and because there's no money in it, like there used to be. And the fact that it's just, it won't sell what they used to sell. And we always laugh because we go, well, let's put out a record. How many is it going to sell? Well, man, maybe we sell 100,000. Well, that'd be a huge failure back in the day. So, you know, it's kind of like, records don't sell like the people download songs, but yeah. People are getting around that. There's ways to get around some of that, releasing on vinyl first, or yeah, I've heard all kinds of stories of what people are trying. But, we're working on a little something, an idea that might make want people to buy the whole thing. And it isn't really our end of it. That's kind of more management and stuff. We still kind of are more hung up on the creative side of it, and we hear, and everybody has talks. We have band meetings with our management, and they talk numbers and they talk this and that. But honestly, Styx is, we're sensible. We don't want to do things that are going to cost money that come out of us being able to feed our families and our crew's families, but you know, it still comes down to, we just love to record, and so it's time, and that's why we're going in. We've been wanting to, we just haven't had time in our schedule, and we decided to look at some times we can go in and kick that ball around a bit and see what we can go with it.
Yeah, I've heard of some bands that are that have said, well, maybe there's no point in even putting out a new album, you know, and that type of thing. And then sometimes it comes down to, but we got into this to write songs, so we just want to do it, you know, and just see whatever happens. Right?
It's, you know, it is an extension of yourself. So, yeah, I mean, this is not going to get too deep with all this, but what I think happens is when you're too business savvy and you let that override creativity, you're robbing yourself. And so you've got to look into avenues to where you can do it, and that's what we're doing. Songwriting is an extension of who you are. It always has been, always will be. I mean, there are people that, you know, cookie cutter songs, and they're good. They become really good at the foundation of how to build a song. That's not what I'm talking about, but that's never been what Styx is, and that's not what I am or Lawrence Gowan is. It's a part of us that we need to complete. It's a part of us that we're depriving ourselves of. We need to search who are we now, and how does that translate into music?
Right.
And I don't get all esoteric about it, but that's really right down to the root of what good songwriting, I think, really is. It comes from a piece of the writer, a piece of the soul. It might not even be a completed personal experience. It might be augmented, but it's an observation.
You know, speaking of reasons or not for putting out new albums and sort of the current industry and all that, what do you and maybe like the guys in the band sort of think about what it's like being a new band these days with the streaming and downloading and all that stuff. And, you know, is it where, like, wow, we were lucky to get in when we got in. We wouldn't know where to start if we had to start today, that type of thing?
Yeah. I mean, where do you start?
Yeah.
And, you know, there's the old joke, you start at the start. Well, okay. But you can do the work. You can find a way to put in the time to write the songs, to complete them. You know, it's easy to write a song. Getting them recorded is, and get them recorded properly, and so they really deserve to be heard, can sometimes be a bit laborious. I'm just finishing up producing the last recordings of Ronnie Montrose. It's taken me a long time. I'm on the road all the time, and so exactly a year ago from now, I took the project from, we were working in San Francisco, but I just, it's so hard for me to get to San Francisco and from the road. So I moved the project to Los Angeles with my old engineer that I used when I was producing Lauren. We're finishing up this week, as a matter of fact. And it is some great music that's being recorded. The basic tracks are awesome. But to get something completed so that it, all the little nuances can shine because they're not covered up by something that's, you know, maybe too busy of playing or too many instruments playing at the same time, or maybe a really strange vocal arrangement that you go, man, this needs to be changed on the top of it. This isn't paying off the chorus. Whatever it is, there are so many examples. But you have to put that time in, I think. And if you can do it every day, you can get it done in a month. You can get it done in 6 weeks. But if you're coming back to it all the time, you have to kind of revisit and figure out, okay, where do we leave off? Just emotionally or mentally, you have to really... there's a lot to uncover. And every time you uncover something, you'll hear something else. So well, I guess what I'm trying to say is that bands can go in and they can spend all the time, especially if they don't have a record company looking over their heads and making them meet a deadline. They can put the time in, whether it's after work or after school or after whatever. It just takes longer. And then now you got this gem. What are you going to do with it? Even right now I'm going through that with this project.
Right.
And I've got a lot of all-stars on this record, and you'd think I could just walk in and say, hey, look who I got. But it's not the same as it was. There's not the infrastructure of record companies doing all of that, doing all the marketing and helping you with your cover art and just kind of mowing down the pathway and having the meetings with the program directors at the radio stations for you and trying to get your song added to the playlist. It's not really like that anymore.
No, it's all over the place.
Yeah. So it's tough, and we talk about it all the time. I don't know how many times I've heard myself, or I'm talking to somebody from another band, say, man, can you imagine being a young musician right now? What would you do? You know, it's an open conversation.
Yeah. Well, you brought up Bad English earlier, and I was a huge fan of Bad English, if I can say so.
Oh,
that was, I love even the second album, which I know wasn't as successful, but I love the second album.
I'm with you there, brother. I'm with you there. That second album has all the tension that we were going through as a band in it, and it doesn't have all of the obvious hits that the first one did, but musically, that second one.
Yeah,
I get some eerie feelings listening to it sometimes.
That's good stuff. I mean, is there, you know, looking back on you know, your long career, so before Styx, you know, with the Babies and Bad English and Coverdale Page and whoever else, you know, on the list. I mean, is there a sort of particular period you're most fond of?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, the Babies, that was just, that's sensational. I mean, that was everything I was hoping the rock band experience would be, but I was younger, you know, so I learned a lot and I made a lot of mistakes, both business wise and just maybe personal lifestyle choice. I was pretty wild, and I was, John Waite and I were trying to conquer the world by, you know, we worked as hard as we partied. It was just an entirely in with both feet, you know, was great. It was a great time, and Tony and Wally and Jonathan, I mean, the we were thick as thieves, and it was just a really good time thinking music still. It hadn't kind of gotten all homogenized as it started to in the more further on into the 80s, I guess. But I really like everything. The time I spent with Jimmy Page and David Coverdale and Denny Carmassi for 5 months making the Coverdale Page record, it was just a real special treat to be just in that company and working every day. And now I'm in Styx. I wouldn't change a thing here. I mean, if you change one thing, you change it all.
Yeah.
And the same thing with Bad English. It was short lived because of probably just too many. It was a real bright flame when we first got started, and boy, was it good. And then, it just burned out quickly. It was too hot of fire right from the beginning, I guess. And nobody really was a listener. Everybody wanted to run the show, and everybody wanted to run the show in different directions. So we were lucky to get the two records we did out of it. I think I've remained friends with everybody. Not everyone is still talking to one another, but that's kind of what I've found happens. And my favorite bands are bands that have one or two really super talented, strong forces, and the rest of the guys are good soldiers. If you get a bunch of everybody's a hotshot musician, a lot of times you're just inviting trouble because the egos just don't, they clash, they don't. Guys, all the maturity of adulthood goes away.
Was, with the first Bad English record, you guys really were a kick-ass rock band. I mean, there's a lot of good rock stuff on that. And then all of a sudden, When I See You Smile becomes sort of this massive hit all over the place. Was that, that was sort of a big thing then with a lot of bands, right? The ballad became the hit. So was that a sort of a good thing, bad thing? How'd you guys look at that?
Well, I don't want to talk people out of who love my song, one of my songs. I don't want to talk anybody out of that. I mean, but it's not my, it wasn't my thing at the time. And I had voted against doing the song. And John Wade came to me and he said, "Ricky, you don't understand. I can make this a number one song." I mean, he stated that. John's a really smart guy.
Right.
And he knows what he's capable of. He'd had a number one song that he'd written. This one he hadn't written. This is a Diane Warren song. Well, as soon as he heard it, he went, "Oh man, I know how to sing this song. It's got all the elements." But there was a thing that was going on at that time where a few people were figuring out the formula that was getting on radio. I didn't dig that, man. I grew up on Yes, and I grew up on Jimi Hendrix and even Cream. I mean, to be able to have songs like they had when they were really just came straight out of the blues, I mean, let's face it, Eric Clapton wanted to be Albert Keating. And so my influences came from a different place. I loved Queen, and I loved, Zeppelin, and I loved David Bowie, and people who were just the interesting arrangements, and they wanted to be different. They didn't want to homogenize. So when I heard that song, it was everything I was against. But
a hit's a hit, yeah. I mean, he knew what he was talking about.
And John said, "Look, let's do this song. I'm telling you, it'll help the record." But I think it really was a dividing pin in what started the downfall of the band. It took a while, but it weakened a little bit of the fabric. Because every other song on that, whether you like them or not, there's something about it, man. There's some magic. Because it was us trying to be a little different. And people who, I've noticed bands that change every year or two, unless it's like David Bowie or Madonna or somebody who's consciously trying to make an image change, and that's cool. I mean, that's great. That's a huge talent that not everybody could do. But if you're just chasing the flavor of the month and trying to sound like what's getting on the radio, well, that's today. I don't think you could do that. But that's what was starting to happen. You're just setting yourself up for disaster because it's going to change again. Now you're being pigeonholed as what was and not what is. And if you stay true to yourself, you'll never have to worry about that. I used to argue that point with everything, but it's a great, the music industry is just a great, wonderful, magical, and terrible place to be.
Exactly.
The crazy dichotomy of all the things I love, but it also can be a bitch. at the same time.
Well, you know, again, you're kicking ass with Styx. You got like a million more shows throughout the first half of the year. The tour with Def Leppard and Tesla kicks back off on the 27th. Then after you're with Def Leppard and Tesla, you guys continue on the road, right?
Yeah, it'll be more of an evening with Styx, and we'll, I think we match up a few times. We're going to get back together with Don Felder in Atlanta. We're doing a big concert, I guess, in May, and I'm not sure who's opening that, but it's kind of one of those things where I can usually stay about a week at a time. Where are you playing next month? I don't know.
Right.
But I know that I'll be playing somewhere because they keep us busy. And I really, really forget if it's Thursday or Friday or Saturday most of the time, and we all do. And as a matter of fact, we used to play this game. Tommy had this little camera, and he'd walk up to you, and he'd turn it on, and he'd go, "Where are we? What day of the week is it? Where were we last night?" Philadelphia? No, we're in Cleveland. You just give up and you just carry on and realize that this, wherever we are, let's rock them.
I can imagine. Well, thanks, Ricky. It was a real pleasure to speak with you, man. I wish you the best on the road, and I'll see you at the next one of the next shows.
Great, man. Thanks a lot. Great questions. Interesting, and I enjoyed it.
All right, man. Thank you. Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
Thanks to Ricky for the interview. For upcoming news and interviews, check theprogreport.com. Follow us on Facebook, @theprogreport on Twitter, or download the podcast on iTunes. Thanks.